Hey, good morning, everybody. My name is Lee Jennings. We've got a couple of announcements for you. Hey, next Sunday, December 19th, we're going to be having baptism. If you're interested in being baptized and following in this step of obedience, then get signed up online at fbcwf.org/baptism. We hope that y'all will join us for one of our Christmas Eve services here at First Baptist. We have two times at every single one of our campuses at 4 o'clock p.m. and 6 o'clock p.m. It's a great opportunity to invite your friends, your family, your neighbors, your co-workers, whoever you want. Let's celebrate the birth of our Savior together. Just a reminder, we have Christmas in the Falls today. Be sure to get your tickets if you haven't already. We have a performance at 3 o'clock and a performance at 7 o'clock. You can get your tickets online or at the door. Show up. Come on. Hey, thank you for choosing to spend your Sunday morning with us. Let's worship together.
Good morning, everyone. Would you join us standing, please? Let's sing Go Tell It on the Mountain. Getting to navigate through.
Yeah, figured that out. Well, good morning. I'm glad that you're here this morning. Merry Christmas. I am really excited about what God is doing in our church and what you're going to experience over these next few hours. Of course, our choir and orchestra has been working very, very hard on presenting a program that's going to bless you, that's going to exalt the Lord Jesus, and is going to pull us back to celebrate the true meaning of Christmas. And so we're excited about what the day brings and what's going to happen. But our hearts are burdened this morning for many of our friends. I have family members in the area of southwestern Kentucky where these terrible storms have hit. They're safe. But I want you to join me in prayer this morning for our friends who have suffered terrible devastation, and many of them have really been through some tough last 48 hours or so. Many of them are still looking for loved ones, not knowing if they've survived or not. This is a terrible, terrible time for the people of that region. And what I want to ask of you this morning is that if the Lord burdens your heart to give, you can give through sendrelief.org. There'll be a website, I think, on the screen that you can see. That's through our North American Mission Board and through the Southern Baptist Convention. And so if you would like to give, that's a very faithful channel. The Red Cross is another way that you can do that. Our church will be discussing ways in which we can respond to this crisis as well. And so I want you to know that. But right now, what I'd like for us to do is join our hearts together to pray for these folks. Father, in the joy of this season and in the celebration that we are about to experience through music and through all of the wonderful things that you allow us to experience, our hearts are heavy and burdened for those in our family of faith and in our country who are suffering right now. Lord, would you wrap your arms around them, bless them. I pray, Father, for rescuers right now. Give them strength for the next few hours that they might be able to pull someone from the rubble and the wreckage. Lord, would you rescue someone today? Pray also this morning for just the church families that have been hurt. Father, many of them have lost lives, and there are pastors who are going to minister to grieving families this morning. We ask you to bless them. Father, would you move now in our midst, and would you allow us to touch your heart this morning, to connect with you in worship? Father, we thank you for your blessings upon our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you join us standing, please?
Thank you.
be seated. Thank you.
know, what I think about is so important about giving is just like, it's so great to be able to be on Facebook. We have friends and grandparents that are not here in Wichita Falls or those that have deployed that can watch our services. And so for so many generations, that older seniors, they're no longer here anymore. So it's time for us to step up. And so I think that's really huge for us to get out there. And, you know, it makes me feel even more willing to want to tithe every month and make sure that happens.
You're so right. We have to step up with our giving and with the things that we do with tithing and giving above and beyond just for the ministries, because Facebook Live, as you were talking about earlier, has reached so many people. I know personally people who work for me, people who don't even live here, go to different churches. They're hearing about Jesus through Facebook Live because it's comfortable for them. They're sitting in their homes, they're watching it on their television, and I just think that's a huge plus.
One of the wonderful things about the media is that it reaches people that are not able to come on Sunday morning. Nancy and I have been members of this church for more than 35 years. And one of the things that we've learned is that giving is part of worship service on Sunday morning. Sometimes we come on Sunday morning and we just want to come and sing and give praise, but giving is a very important part of that. And if we're not doing that, then we're not supporting these different ministries, whether it's media or outreach or whatever it might be.
We have so many more homebound members than we've had in the past, and never did I think I would be one of those at this age, for sure. But with the pandemic, all the things that have happened, we ended up spending a lot of our time on the sofa, watching and listening to Pastor Bob, and through our giving, it has allowed us to upgrade some of our equipment, and so that you really feel like you're right there, and it's really an interesting time to see.
One of the important things, I think, to me, when we were younger, we kind of were afraid to give in a sense that it wasn't going to be enough, it really wouldn't have an impact. And that's really not the case. I mean, we look at Christ when he was talking about the widow, when she threw in her little mites. And everybody thought, well, the people giving so much was so important. And it does help. I mean, it's great. But the thing that he showed that was so important was the heart that was given it, not just the amount. And he wants a cheerful giver. And it's been, as he said before also, it's better to give than to receive, but mainly the heart of it. And it really changed when we started giving appropriately, and so just a dollar here, a dollar there. When we really started looking at it, there came a joy, and that was from the heart. It wasn't from the amount, it was from the heart.
Your faithful giving in the month of December is very, very important to the ministry of our church. As we look toward 2022, it's almost hard to believe I'm saying those numbers, but as we look toward 2022, there are a lot of ministry opportunities that are going to be available to us, and opportunities for us to give and to go and to share the message of God's love. And so I want to encourage you in your giving, especially in the month of December, which is so important to the future ministries of our church. Let's take our Bibles this morning and open them to Isaiah chapter 8. In Isaiah chapter 8, we're going to look at a passage of Scripture that actually moves into chapter 9, so you may want to keep your Bibles open because I won't read the entire passage at one point, but we're going to talk about hope this morning. And we're going to talk about the reality that hope has a name. In January of this past year, about 11 months ago, there was an explosion at the Hushan gold mine in the Shandong province of China. There was very little hope that there would be any survivors. But after 7 days, on January 17th, a rope had been lowered through an air shaft, a very narrow air shaft, that there would be no way for a man to come up out of the mine or to go back down into the mine. But they could lower a rope through that air shaft. And after 7 days, rescuers felt a tug on that rope. Eventually, they got a note up to the surface to those who were attempting rescue. And the note read, basically, there are 11 of us. We need medicine and we need food. And then it concluded with this. We hope that rescue will not stop. We have hope. Thank you. Those men were trapped at the bottom of a mine, 2,000 feet below the surface of the earth, and they were praying, they were hoping, they were striving toward the fact that maybe someone wouldn't give up on them and they would be rescued. 11 men were pulled eventually out of that mine. But maybe you feel a bit like those miners at the bottom of that, mine after that cave-in and explosion. You feel trapped. You feel like there's no way out. And for some of us this morning, we're in that place where hope is waning. Perhaps you're walking through a season of suffering right now. Maybe in your life it's almost like there's one catastrophe after another. There's one pressure point after another. Perhaps you're just overwhelmed with crisis, a financial crisis, a relational crisis. Maybe it's marital in your case, or maybe there's a situation with your children. But for some of you, it's what I simply call the snowball effect of one issue on top of another that just continues to get compacted into a huge burden that we bear. Many of us in this room know what it feels like to hope that rescue will not stop. We have hope. But for some of us, there is a sense of almost hopelessness. We feel like there's no way out of the stress and out of the mess that we find ourselves in. For others, maybe you had hope, but you placed it in something that was never really able to give you hope. Maybe it's a false hope that was never going to fix it, but only make it worse. Sometimes people think they're going to find hope or they're going to experience hope, and what they go after doesn't fulfill them at all. Maybe it's why we turn to a liquor store, or maybe it's why we go to the casinos, or maybe it's why we pursue another relationship. And there's always some striving after something that will fulfill the longing of our life and of our hearts. Well, the Old Testament prophet Isaiah had some words for us that we desperately need to hear. In a place that we can find authentic, real, living hope. The Old Testament prophet Isaiah lived 700 years before the birth of Christ. And he lived during some very dark days in the history of Israel. Now, by the time Isaiah comes onto the scene, we have a divided kingdom. That point in the Old Testament where all Bible students get a little bit confused about who's who. Is it the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom? Is it Israel? Is it Judah? Let me help you. It's about 700 BC, and the Assyrians have attacked and they have conquered the northern kingdom of Israel. But Isaiah now is speaking to the southern kingdom of Judah, and they feel like they are on the verge of captivity as well. Now, God will miraculously move, and that won't be the case for them. However, what they experience is this life that is sensing what happens when you reject God. And that's the first thing that I want you to see this morning, is that the truth that life can be really dark and painful. There is a fact that life can be really dark and painful. You see, these people were religious, they'd also rejected God. Their religion by this point had become a strange mixture of scripture and tradition and pagan practices, even witchcraft and political conspiracies. And as a result of that, the Bible says that God had turned his face away from them. Listen to what the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 17. "And I will wait for the Lord, who is hiding his face from the house of Jacob. I will even look eagerly for him." Isaiah says, I am going to wait because the Lord has turned his face away from them. What does it mean for the Lord to turn his face away from someone, from his people? Well, essentially it's a metaphor to say that God has withdrawn his manifest presence from his people. And when God withdraws his presence from his people, then what follows is this, that we no longer have his power to do our to fulfill our mission. We no longer have his protection on our lives, and we no longer have his provision. That is what the nation of Judah is experiencing in this moment, because they had turned their back on God. He has withdrawn. He has hidden his face from them. What does it look like when God withdraws, or when God hides his face from us? Well, listen to chapter 8, verse 21. In chapter 8, verse 21, the Bible says they will pass through the land hard-pressed and famished. And it will turn out that when they are hungry, they will be enraged and curse their king and their God as they face upward. Then they will look to the earth and behold distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish, and they will be driven away into darkness. Those words are incredibly interesting when you study them in the Hebrew language. Each word is increasing in its intensity. Things just get worse and they get worse. There is a sense in which there is an increasing gloom and desperation in all of those words. Let me just pick apart a few of them. I won't try to parse every verb in the passage. But he says the people will become hard-pressed. The word means to be heavily burdened. It's the word for a load being placed on a beast of burden, on an ox or on a donkey. And he's saying they will be hard-pressed. They will be burdened. There will be a sense that life has placed a load on their shoulders. Not only that, but they will be famished. He says in verse 21 that they'll be hard-pressed and famished. The word famished means to be hungry, to experience a shortage, for there to be never to be enough. Not only that, but we're told in this passage of Scripture that they'll be enraged. Look at verse 21. They will be enraged and curse their king and their God as they face upward. It's as if there was a sense of ever-burning anger in the lives of the people of Isaiah's day. There was a constant sense of rage, a constant sense of anger and bitterness. And they were bitter at their king, they blamed their government, and they blamed their God. It's always somebody's fault when something goes wrong. We've got to have somebody to blame. And so the people are experiencing not only a sense of being hard-pressed and burdened, of shortage and a lack of necessities in life, but there's an anger about them. And then listen to these words. He says in verse 22, then they will look to the earth and behold distress and darkness, gloom of anguish, and they will be driven away into darkness. Does anybody see our world in those words? I mean, these words were written 2,700 years ago. And yet Isaiah seems to have been writing from our headlines today. You see, this is what happens when you decide you don't need God. This is what happens when you decide that you can make it on your own. God says, okay, go your own way. You want to leave me out? I won't stay where I'm unwelcome. And he simply takes his hand off the situation. And then all of a sudden, things begin to happen that go downward and downward and downward. And this doesn't just happen in a nation. It happens in an individual life. Here's Isaiah's point. If I could make Isaiah's point very simply, Isaiah's point is this. You made your choices. Now your choices are making you. You get to make all your choices, but you don't get to choose the consequences of those choices. You can make all your choices, and then your choices make you. When it comes to our marriages, we can make a choice of marital faithfulness. And when you make the choice, then that choice begins to make you in a positive direction. But you can also make your choice of marital infidelity, and then your choice will make you. We make choices with our finances. We make choices about what we spend our money on. Are we generous? Do we give, or do we hoard it all to ourselves? You can make your choices, and then your choices will make you. None of us get to escape the consequences of the choices that we make. Israel and Judah didn't get to escape them, and neither do we in this day and age. Now, when these sort of terrible things begin to happen, there are at least three ways in which we look at them. The first is simply this. I can be honest and say, you know what? I made some bad choices, and therefore I'm getting bad consequences. Every now and then I have to look in the mirror and say, Bob, you really messed that one up. You made a choice, and now you get to live with the consequences of your choice. All of us would be honest and say there have been moments in our life when that's happened. But sometimes, maybe you didn't do it. But you're living with the reality of generational consequences for behavior in your life. No, you didn't deserve to be abused. No, you didn't deserve to have to be treated in the way you were treated. Maybe it was somebody else's fault, but you're living with the fallout of it. You see, these prophecies were made 700 years before Jesus, and it's going to be 700 years before hope arrives. It's going to be 700 years before the solution comes to these problems. And surely somewhere along the way, there's a generation that goes, wait a minute, we didn't mess this up. But you're living with the results of generational sin. And that happens sometimes, and we have to acknowledge that. But sometimes there are problems and distress and disasters that sweep into our life that it's not my fault, it's not my mama's fault, it's not my grandmama's fault. It just happens. And we have to wonder, why in the world do these things happen? Sometimes it's Adam and Eve's fault. I mean, if they had never taken that fruit from the tree, this world wouldn't be as jacked up as it is. Every year, every time some of this stuff happens, like these horrible, horrible tornadoes in Kentucky, somebody, I will guarantee you, if it didn't happen yesterday, and I didn't watch any news, so I don't know, but they'll bring some pastor on, and they'll say, why did God let this happen? And sometimes they'll have a faithful pastor on who's actually read the Bible, and he'll give them a really good answer. And sometimes they'll have some guy who's just totally confused, or some lady who's totally confused on there, and will give a terrible answer that doesn't point anybody to hope or help or anything else. Let me tell you why disasters happen. When Adam and Eve sinned against a holy God, the Bible says that all of creation was subjected to futility. The weather is messed up because of sin. Disasters sweep into our lives and into our world because all of creation is under the curse of sin, and only Jesus can fix it. That's the answer. And so Isaiah says, here's the truth, that life can be really dark and really painful. But there is a turning point when hope arises. Now, in your Bibles, if you'll take a look at them, you're going to see something at the end of verse 22. It's a chapter break. And in our minds, that means totally different subject. We put the chapter breaks in. Isaiah was just writing, and chapter 8 just flows into chapter 9. In chapter 9, verse 1, Isaiah says, but there will be no more gloom for her who was in anguish. In earlier times, he treated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali with contempt. But later on, he shall make it glorious by the way of the sea, on the other side of the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them. You shall multiply the nation. You shall increase their gladness. They will be glad with your presence and with the gladness of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you shall break the yoke of their burden, and the staff on their shoulders, the rod of the oppressor, as at the battle of Midian. For every boot of the booted warrior in the battle of tumult and cloak rolled in blood will be for burning fuel for the fire. You see, what happens is this. Isaiah says, all of this, these horrible things, this darkness and this distress is coming because you've turned your back on God. But God has not completely abandoned you. Hope is going to rise. Now understand this. The turnaround is coming. Isaiah promises that the turnaround is coming, but it hasn't yet arrived. But he wants to tell them that there is coming a day. There is coming a day when God is going to make Israel have a comeback. There's going to be a turnaround in all of their fortunes and fates. One of my favorite stories of someone who experienced something like that is a guy named Jim Braddock. Jim Braddock was a heavyweight boxer. Back in the days when boxing was sort of the king of all sports in America. It was the late 1920s, and Jim Braddock made a lot of money boxing, but he lost it all in the stock market crash of 1929. He went from living in the penthouse to being penniless. And he still was trying to make a living as a boxer, but he injured his right hand. And his right hand was his dominant hand. It was the hand that he threw the best punches with. And so he wound up working as a dock worker. He's lost all of his fortune. He's lost all of his fame. He's working as a dock worker. And because it took a long time for his hand to heal in a day and age without physical therapy and without the knowledge of how to heal a hand like that, he wound up using his left hand a lot more as a dock worker. And his left arm got stronger and stronger. Well, eventually, his right hand healed, and he decided he would try boxing again. He got back in the ring, and he had some success, and then he had a setback or two, and he'd win a match, and he'd lose a match, and some things started just to sort of go his way. And one night, he was on a card. He was on the undercard. However, only a few days before, the guy that was supposed to fight, the heavyweight champion of the world, got sick and had to withdraw from the fight, and Jim Braddock was elevated to fight for the heavyweight championship, and he defeated the heavyweight champion of the world, a guy named Max Baer, knocked him out, and as a result of that, he went from absolutely having everything to having nothing to having everything again. It was a great turnaround. It was a comeback. And what God says is, I've got a comeback that is coming. In this verse of Scripture, in this passage of Scripture, he says, this is all going to come. And when it comes, all of the fates are going to be turned around. He says they're going to be in darkness, but then in verse 2 of this passage, he says the people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Everything that has gone wrong is going to be set right. God's going to send light. In the Old Testament, light is the symbol of life and hope. In Psalm chapter 27, verse 1, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I dread? The Lord is the defense of my life. Whom shall I dread? You see, in this passage of Scripture, he promises that hope is coming. And it's really interesting that he points out a specific region, because he points out that that hope is going to come in chapter 9, verse 1. From the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. He says, in earlier times, he treated the land of Naphtali and Zebulun with contempt. Now, here's what you need to know about the history of this. All of this is being written and prophesied when the Assyrians have attacked the northern kingdom. And a lot of this is very confusing, so I thought a map might help. I thought a map just might help. Here's a map of where Zebulun and Naphtali would be. Now, if you look up at the top, there's a very bright green spot. And that's my best way to point it out to you. That is Zebulun. It was the smallest of all the territories, of all the tribal territories given to the tribes of Israel. Then just above that, there is the area of Naphtali. And Naphtali borders on that blue spot, which is the Sea of Galilee. That's where the region that he's talking about. And he says, that area has been treated with contempt. When the Assyrians invaded the land of Israel, essentially that was where they came. That was where they camped. They took all the land from the people. They took the people into captivity. They took them off to Assyria. That portion of Israel was the worst treated during that particular time. But he says, I'm going to make it glorious. He says, I'm going to make it glorious by way of the seas on the other side of the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. Here's what he's saying to them. Hope is coming, but it's not here yet. Hope is coming, but you're going to have to wait for it. Some of you who are walking through some of the things that I described in the first part of this message, you're saying, okay, Bob, I'm ready for it. I'm ready for hope. Hope is coming, but you're going to have to wait for it. One of the things that we are not good at, one of the things that we don't want to do is wait for anything in our world. You know, when I was a kid growing up, I think the most exciting day of the year wasn't my birthday. I think the most exciting day of the year was when the Sears and Roebuck wish book arrived at our house. Man, that was just a delight. And I'm so glad to be talking to a group of people who can relate to that. Because there was nothing like that. I still remember the smell of the Sears and Roebuck wish book. It had a distinct smell to it. And of course, I would go to those pages that had the toys or the athletic equipment or whatever it was, and you'd look through there, and I can remember it was the only time of year you could ever look at and find all the jerseys of every NFL team, of every Major League Baseball team, and you could ask for one of those for Christmas. And boy, I was always pumped up about the wish book. And that thing would be dog-eared by the time my brother and I got finished with that, where we had turned down page after page of things that we were going to ask Santa Claus for. We were so excited about that. You could wish, but you had to wait. Oh, you had to wait. We don't have to wait anymore. I mean, order it on Amazon Prime and it'll be here 2 days from now. They're even experimenting with Prime Now, which is packages delivered by drone that if you order it, it will be on your doorstep within 3 hours. We don't like waiting. And we'll devise any way that we can to make sure we don't have to wait. Hope is coming, but you're going to have to wait. You see, as followers of Jesus, I am convinced that what we have to do is learn to wait faithfully. What does faithful waiting look like? Well, faithful waiting looks like this. It means that we hang on to the hope that God is good, that His word is true, that He keeps His promises, that He always responds in a way that is faithful to us. Now, even God waits for the perfect time for things. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. The Bible says, when the fullness of time came, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law. When the fullness of time came, God waited for the perfect moment. Some of you wonder sometimes, why is God not coming through? Why is God not rescuing me? Why is God not answering my prayers? Why is God not fixing this terrible problem that I've got? Maybe you're not ready yet. Maybe you're not ready yet. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 says, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you when? Say it out loud. At the proper time. It may not be an issue that somehow you're not striving enough. Some people think, well, I'm not doing enough, or maybe I've got to do something that's going to make God's hand move. Maybe it's just a timing issue. And you've got to learn to wait faithfully. Well, some of you are like, okay, Bob, this is great. I get it. You're giving me some history here, but what in the world has this got to do with Christmas? I'm so glad you asked, because I'm getting there. Christmas is the reason we have this living hope. Not trees and tinsel and all that, no. I'm talking about the meaning of Christmas. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Now remember, this is all one thought. It's all one continuous thought when Isaiah is writing it. And he says, I'm telling you guys, hope's coming. It's bad right now. It's dark. It's distressing. It's depressing. But God is going to send hope at the proper time. And in chapter 9, verse 6, for a child will be born to us. A son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or peace. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness, from then on and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. For a child will be born to us. Hope comes from the birth of the Messiah. You see, Isaiah is saying to this crowd of people, it's dark and it's distressing, and you've turned your back on God, but he still loves you. And he's going to send a baby, and this will be no ordinary baby. He's going to send a child, and this child will be called a Wonderful Counselor. You can go to him for the best advice. He's going to be called the Mighty God. The power of God will be embodied in a human person. He says he's going to be the Eternal Father. Now, some people find that confusing. But even Jesus said, I and the Father are one. The disciples came to Jesus on one occasion. They said, Jesus, would you show us the Father? I mean, they really believed the stuff. And Jesus responded to them, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Now, the Trinity are three distinct persons. But there is a oneness and a unity in the Trinity that makes them one God. And when he says Eternal Father, I believe what he's talking to us about is the relational aspect of the God of the universe who wants to take you into his family, who wants to receive you. Some of you are going to go to family gatherings this Christmas, and they've been jacked up for a long time, and they've been troublesome for a long time, and there's always, you know, that person you got to walk around, walk on eggshells, and you wonder if you're going to get pushed out of the door almost. Well, there's a family that you can be a part of that you'll never get kicked out of, that'll never shun you, that'll never push you to the side. And that's the family of an Eternal Father. And he says, this baby's going to be the Prince of Peace. That word peace, shalom, wholeness, unity, oneness, a sense of everything being right. Does that mean peace with God? Does it mean peace within? Or does it mean peace with others? Yes, that's what it means. Because once you become at peace with God, then you can have peace within. And once you have peace within, you can make peace with others. It's all three. And he says, this baby's going to come, and he's going to bring all of these blessings, and he's going to turn the anguish and the darkness and the gloom that Naphtali and Zebulun experienced, and he's going to make it glorious. Now, here's what this has got to do with Christmas. Matthew wrote his gospel primarily to a Jewish audience. Matthew's gospel was primarily written to Jews. And in Matthew chapter 4, verse 12, here's what Matthew wrote. Now, when Jesus heard that John had been taken into custody, he withdrew into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and settled in Capernaum, which is by the sea in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet, through Isaiah the prophet, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali by way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who were sitting in darkness saw a great light, and those who were sitting in the land in the shadow of death, upon them the light has dawned. Matthew is saying the child that Isaiah talked about 700 years ago, it's Jesus. He's fulfilled every single prophecy of the Old Testament. And hope comes through believing in Him. You can't preach on hope, I don't think, without at least talking about Romans 5, 15, 13. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. People in our generation want hope. They want joy. They want peace. They just want it without God. And that's not possible. If you want hope, joy, and peace, it is only found in believing. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you this morning to glory in the name of Jesus. We thank you for the prophecies that were written hundreds of years before. We thank you for the validation of fulfilled prophecy. That Jesus isn't just a prophet, that he is the promised one. And Father, I pray for those who've come to this place today or those who are watching, who are experiencing a sense of hopelessness. Father, would you point them to your Son, Jesus? By your Spirit, draw him, draw them to him. I pray this morning that they would experience your joy, your peace, and your hope in believing. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to stand and we're going to sing together. If you'd like to make a decision to trust Christ to be a part of this church, you come.
Sent down for the world to see. Let the grace you've shown be evident in me. Let this Christmas be Christ in me. Let this Christmas be Christ in me. The love of God sent down.
You can remain standing. We're going to get you out of here pretty quick to life group, but I want to ask Ann Harrison to come and join me. Ann is our director of women's ministries, and we are very excited for her that Ann graduated from Southeastern Baptist Theological Seminary on Friday with her master's in women's studies or ministry to women? Yeah. Master's in ministry to women. But we wanted to tell Anne how proud we are of her and how thankful we are all her study and hard work to equip herself to minister even better to the ladies of our church. So Anne, congratulations. Thank you so much for being here. God bless you. Y'all have a great day.